Get me
Randy Orton!
He's unavailable.
Then get me his non-union Mexican equivalent.
A WTF! A WTF!
Bon qui qui! Je m'appelle Ross Tweddell from Cultaholic.com and welcome to all the WTF moments from a fantastic evening of professional wrestling action at WWE Super Showdown 2019. Who am I kidding? Let's rename the thing WWE Super Show every single year for the next 8 years. And isn't it ironic, don't you think, that everybody on that card last night was taking a massive fat paycheck from a regime who was all for a bit of beheading? Then we got that main event last night and The Undertaker and Goldberg quite literally almost took each other's heads off. I'm sad. But we begin things about an hour or so before the kickoff show started last night with the news that the proposed match between Alexa Bliss and Natalya was not sanctioned by the Saudi government. Despite the fact WWE reportedly pushed hard for the match to take place, the Saudi government said, no, no, we cannot have women doing wrestling in our wrestling ring. One word for you, Saudi Arabia. Progressive. Two more for you, pals. Absolute bollocks. And here's three more for you about this relationship with WWE, a crock of bollocks. And then we get to Charlie Caruso, who kicked off the kickoff show by saying the following. If you haven't heard, Super Showdown is going to be the equivalent, if not exceed, WrestleMania. Believe me, Charlie, we have heard. It's been said so many pissing times over the last few weeks, it's become the new It's Boss Time! Oh, here comes the dog! And then when Charlie introduced that void of worthless wasteland right there, she asks, what doesn't he do? I mean, where the hell do I start, Charlie? Do anything worthwhile in WWE? Does that work for you? Validate his position on these here kickoff shows where he does nothing but state the bleeding obvious and bore everyone watching to tears. And maybe enjoy life by having one single carb. Dave, who knows? You might have a carb. You might get a bit of charisma, a bit of crack, and actually prove you're worthwhile a position on that there show. Have a pie. It might change for you. And now we have Charlie once again, who claimed that The Undertaker and Goldberg were fighting to keep their legacies intact at Super Showdown 2019. That went well, didn't it? More on that later. And then a rogue Paul Heyman appeared who tried to explain why Brock didn't cash in his Money in the Bank contract on Seth Rollins on this week's Raw, despite the fact that Rollins was quite literally dead in the middle of the ring. Paul talked about how Seth kicked Brock in the Beast Incarnate, and therefore Brock has to get revenge before he can take the Universal Championship back off Seth Rollins, when undoubtedly Seth would be more alive than he was in this week's Raw. Just say he's a massive bleeding idiot, man, Paul, and every single thing Brock did on this week's Raw made absolutely no sense, because on this week's Raw, was the reigning defending undisputed champion of the numpties. Take that one. And then we have David Otunga questioning whether Seth Rollins should actually be competing at Super Showdown 2019 due to the attack from Brock Lesnar on this week's Raw. And can you just imagine what Vince McMahon was saying backstage?
God damn it, you Harvard lawyer! Piece of crap! That was only a little purple on his back! You have to lose a head, or an arm, or a leg to be injured in the WWE!
Because in wrestling, for some reason you have to be like proper dead to get time off for injuries and whatnot, because you have to prove you're hard by working with injuries and stuff. It's weird wrestling. A moment of silence and reflection, please, as Robert Roode returns to being Bobby Roode by getting rid of that thick and girthy slug off his top lip that made every single woman who saw it bear preggers. David Otunga says Dolph Ziggler is salty. Betty Phoenix says that Dolph Ziggler is bitter and sour. Anybody else fancy a Chinese takeaway? And back to Otunga we go once again, who says that Andrade, he's been in the ring with your boy Fimbulo once before. He knows what to expect, but the demon in the ring with him there, that's a different ball game. No, it's not, you knob. As we all know, there's two glaring issues with the demon character in WWE, the first of which is when your boy Fimbulo actually uses the damn thing. We're at the Royal Rumble in January, we're facing Brock Lesnar for the Universal Championship, but we don't use our unbeatable demon character. Here we are in Saudi Arabia, a house show basically, Andrade in the Continental title. Let's whap it out. Makes no sense. And of course, the second one is the fact that the demon Finbalor does nothing different to the basic bitch Finbalor in the ring, in between the ropes, the same moves, the same movements. All we get different is a fancy entrance with a seductive crawl along the ring. Look at his peachy ass, will ya? So I, Dave, he knows what's coming. Now, I initially thought that was a microphone on the side of Byron Saxton's heat, but on closer inspection, it turns out it's not, and there's only one question to ask here, and that question is, what are those? Byron, for Christ's sake, get rid of those. They could not be more 1998 if you tried. And next up, we have Betty Phoenix, the Phoenix one who claims that we haven't seen a monster yet from Lars Sullivan, who, of course, is the man who was beating up every single person in his path, who, of course, is the man who Vince McMahon calls a freak. And, of course, is the man who has wreaked havoc like a monster, a different kind of monster, on many, many internet forums. What more do you want from him, Betty? Question, is Triple H shrinking?
Yes.
I'm back today with Otunga We Go once again, who quite literally does not know the difference between evolution and legacy. There he was talking about the days of legacy when Triple H was apparently a mentor to Randy Orton. That's not how it goes, Dave. Well, I guess they do say that evolution is a mystery, so of course that numpty's not going to understand it, is he? And of course, in that moment, we had an inadvertent little sly mention for one throne breaker, not toilets. Cody Rhodes. Quelle surprise, as the French would say. David Otunga making a mistake on the pre-show for Super Showdown 2019 when he claims that he hasn't seen Braun Strowman manhandled like he was by Bobby Lashley on this week's Raw. I don't know about you, but I reckon Dave should take a look at No Mercy 2017 when one F5 from Brock Lesnar saw him off all the time that several men murdered him in the back of a garbage truck. So as sweaty Michael Cole lets us know, it's 102 degrees in the stadium in Jeddah, Saudi Arabia, and I checked the internet, and get this right, not a single flood warning was issued for Jeddah just before last night's main card kicked off. How the hell can you have a setting with 100 degree heat and Curl amongst sweaty bollocks in line to perform in the ring and not have a single flood warning for the entirety of Saudi Arabia? The entire country was in danger of being submerged. Now, we all heard the story where Michael Cole gave Pat McAfee a stern telling off for wearing shorts on the WrestleMania kickoff show, and that was referenced on last night's kickoff show for Super Showdown. And of course, the WTF moment here has to be when Renee Young piped up and said, well, at least he wouldn't get in trouble this time. New sites with a Z would have bonus if she said that, as the wife of John Moxley shoots on Michael Cole and shoots on WWE. Spunk everywhere. Renee is All Elite confirmed. And we end all the WTF moments from the kickoff show with a moment that had me saying, bless Charlie Caruso. They have her, quite literally, standing on a little black box because she's so little. Aww. And to the opening package for the main card we go, which claimed that tonight is all about exceeding every expectation. Now, as we all know, with all of the bull bollockry that goes around with these Saudi Arabia shows and the circumstances to do with that, expectations for these Saudi shows are as low can be. But despite this low bar, last night's show still didn't meet that expectation, so you failed, WWE. Nice one. Equivalent or better than WrestleMania, WWE. They are here, they are there. They are every pissing where. Empty seats. Empty seats. Maggle, 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 maggle. So according to Michael Cole, big baldy bastard Baron Corbin has dreamed of being Universal Champion ever since the days when he was the commissioner of Monday Night Raw. You mean constable or general manager-elect, you tits, don't you? Now, I know what you're thinking, Ross, those are just different titles for the same job, but I'm here to tell you, no, 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 they are so different, it would take me longer to explain than Undertaker takes to walk to the ring these days. Honestly. So we got off to a rip-roaring start with these funny bastards, didn't we? So Corey Graves reels off the names to introduce those fellas. Then that bloke in the middle replies to Corey Graves by saying, and I thought Renee would butcher it, but Corey didn't. I mean, first of all, butcher was a choice word to use, wasn't it, pal? And second of all, Corey read the link. Renee had nothing to do with it. So why are you criticizing Renee, you plum? Oh, yeah, that's right. Women weren't even allowed driving licenses in Saudi Arabia until this time last year. So of course Renee's a rubbish presenter, even when she doesn't say a thing. And speaking of the women, that woman there was quite literally picked up and taken out of the arena by security. If you know why, please tell me. I'd like to know. And next up we have Jeddah's favourite son. And I'm just making this a WTF moment because big bully bastard Baron Corbin should just say he is Jeddah's favourite son everywhere he goes in the world. And he's a heel. Good heel work, big bully bastard Baron Corbin. Look! It's a woman. Look at the woman having a great time at the WWE wrestling event, which is the equivalent to or bigger than WrestleMania. We're really progressive, us. Honest. Yeah. No, don't show that. So next up, we have the moment where big bully bastard Baron Corbin gets a steel chair in a singles match where steel chairs are illegal. John Cohn was all like, no, big bully bastard Baron Corbin, don't use that chair, big bully bastard Baron Corbin, or I will disqualify you, big bully bastard Baron Corbin. And then big bully bastard Baron Corbin drops the chair to the floor, corners John Cohn in the corner of the ring and shouts, I know how to do my job. Do you know how to do yours? I mean, big bully bastard Baron Corbin, you clearly don't. You were going to use a steel chair in a singles match where steel chairs are banned. And then John Cohn did what I am going to call a reverse Bret Hart, because he turned heel in Jeddah, Saudi Arabia, but he turned babyface around the world everywhere else. Because he screwed big baldy bastard Baron Corbin. Yes, we saw the Jeddah screw job. And I don't know about you, but I cannot believe we did not see big baldy bastard Baron Corbin wiping out his can of air spray paint and spray painting AEW. Who am I kidding? They don't want that, Crockett. But I guess the booking here has to be mentioned as well as a bit of a WTF moment. Because on one hand, it was good to see the heel get his comeuppance for bullying that little innocent referee. On the other hand, I felt a bit sorry for big baldy bastard Baron Corbin. He quite literally got screwed out of the biggest match of his career. And here's a direct quote from Seth Rollins while he was twatting Brock Lesnar upside the hair with a steel chair.
How does it feel, you big ugly son of a bitch?
I've just realised that Seth Rollins and Adam Pacitti sound the same, don't they?
Dun, 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 dun.
So it turns out that when WWE in Saudi Arabia, replays are just what's happening in the ring, but from a different angle. Now, I've got to admit, I stole this from a person who watched our live stream last night, so thank you to that person for enlightening me and opening my world to new possibilities. But surely, when your boy Finn Balor, when he's the demon, loses more paint, he has to become less demonish and more human Finn Balor. So then, why was he still being more demony when he was looking just like basic bitch Finn Balor towards the end of that match against Andrade at Super Showdown last night? Wouldn't it be amazing to see somebody at the start of a match against demon Finn Balor just whap out a bucket and a sponge and wipe that paint off? Then he becomes normal, doesn't he? And he's not very good when he's not. He is very good when he's normal. But you know what I mean. My finish! My finish! I don't know why this made me laugh so hard, but it did. More superstars need to be audibly gutted when their finisher doesn't work just after another superstar kicks out from it. And next up we have Michael Cole, who claims the demon Finn Balor has never been defeated in WWE. Isn't it cool? That's despite the fact, of course, that NXT TakeOver The End, inside a steel cage, Samoa Joe defeated a man in paint who looked like Demon Finn Balor. And of course, Triple H, NXT is WWE's third brand, isn't it? On the same level as Raw and SmackDown Live.
Viking experience.
Money flying around everywhere. Symbolism at its finest at Super Showdown 2019. Now look at the state of him just after he finished his entrance, for Christ's sake. Forget about Saudi Arabia just being the ones under threat of a massive flood due to the perspiration coming off Shane McMahon's forehead. I was worried in Newcastle that the River Tyne would burst its banks due to that sweaty bastard's sweat. But somehow, someway, Colonel McSweaty Bollocks, despite looking like that, just after his entrance, for Christ's sake, did not sweat as much as Brock Lesnar at Super Showdown 2019. If he didn't say it, Brock Lesnar left a Brock Lesnar in a puddle, all those bodily feuds in the middle of the ring just after Seth Rollins attacked him with a steel chair. But during Shane's match against Roman Reigns, no puddles were seen, and I don't know what's real anymore. Colonel McSweaty Bollocks taking a bump after one of Roman Reigns' big punches. I can't believe it. We must have seen Roman Reigns twat that twat upside the head about 20 times over the past few weeks, but has Shane McMahon taking a bump? Has he bollocks, despite the fact everybody else in WWE, even Brock Lesnar, I'm sure, fall on their back when the big dog punches them upside the head. So then, seeing Shane actually put on his arse by a punch from Roman Reigns has to be a bigger shock than seeing Anthony Joshua put on his respective arse a few times last weekend. Now, I know this shouldn't really be a WTF moment, because as we've learned on WTF moments over the past year and a half, at least a year, Shane McMahon is the best professional wrestler in the world today. But old, middle-aged, sweaty, delusional Joe Rogan wannabe Shane McMahon not only took the mighty Roman Reigns to a competitive match on his own, forget about Drew McIntyre, but Shane McMahon pinned Roman Reigns, and not only that, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, Shane McMahon handed Roman Reigns his first pinfall defeat in WWE since Roman was forced to relinquish the Universal Championship. Because as we all know, Shane McMahon, that young upstart with his sweaty bollocks full of potential, really needed that star-making victory now, didn't he? This was the day that the professional wrestling business went absolutely mental, and let me tell you why. Let's go back to 1991. The Undertaker makes his WrestleMania debut. Fast forward all the way to 2014, The Undertaker loses his streak to Brock Lesnar at WrestleMania 30. Fast forward to 2018, Roman Reigns finally defeats the man who ended the streak and therefore became the hardest man in the history of professional wrestling by winning the Universal Championship from Brock Lesnar. And now here we are in Saudi Arabia on a show equivalent or better than WrestleMania, and Colonel McSweaty Bollocks is beating the man who beat the man who ended the streak. Did that make sense? It did in my head. It might not have yours, but you know what I mean. The last 28 years of history in WWE was built towards building Shane McMahon, who of course is the best professional wrestler in the world today. The last 28 years was all towards this moment of making Shane McMahon the undeniable best professional wrestler in the history of WWE. But poor old Drew McIntyre there, because he's got Colonel McSweaty Bollocks' sweaty bollocks on his neck, with the stuff dripping down his back undoubtedly. But Ross, I love the ball just trickling down my spine. I feel like a lovely big ham with some honey glazing. Drew McIntyre earned that big Saudi payday more than anybody else, I don't care what you say. And next up we have Michael Cole, who was bigging up Kalisto, of all people, for some reason. He's a former United States champion, he's a former tag team champion, but he's never been in the ring with a freak like Lars Sullivan.
Bollocks.
Now sit down everybody, get a stiff drink, because if you don't know this, it might end your life. But Kalisto owns a victory over Braun Strowman. But of course Michael didn't mention that, because it's irrelevant when he's taking on a big man like Lars Sullivan. So big, bad, scary Lars Sullivan won his first official WWE match against three men who, when put together, are still half the size of that big sweaty man by disqualification. I'm sorry, Lars, but if you can't beat the little Lucha House Party, there's no hope for you, pal. And I don't know if you're going soft on the Lucha House Party because of this sensitivity training you're going through, but that sensitivity training does not apply to action inside the ring. If you're going to be billed as a monster inside the ring, rip the bleeding heads off, or we might as well paint you green. You're halfway to being Shrek. We might as well make you all the way Shrek. Onto the steel. That's not cool, guys. When the hell has steel been able to change colour like that stuff there, Michael Cole? Tell me when. Never. No, I don't know about you, but I would have thought after WrestleMania 35 and what Michael Cole said immediately after Triple H's entrance, a thing that made me throw a can of dark fruits across the ring. Precious dark fruits. I love dark fruits, me. I would have thought Triple H would have taken Michael Cole to one side and said, well, Michael, never ever are. That's a hard impression to do. Never say anything's cool when it's relating to me. But there we were last night. Triple H was being the cerebral dad ass on his tricycle, and Michael Cole piped up again at the end of the entrance and said the following. Well, you know it's a WrestleMania caliber event when Triple H has a bad ass entrance like that, guys. Once again, people at home, if Michael Cole ever says anything is cool or funny or bad ass, it's anything but. I am the snake, Randy Orton, and I will hurt you with the three most painful letters in the World Wrestling Federation. R, kick and car, R. And here's a direct quote from Corey Graves, who said the following. Randy Orton competes week after week on SmackDown Live. Now, I'm here to tell you that Randy Orton has only competed in six matches so far in 2019. And this week right here is the 23rd week of 2019. Now, I know that WWE make a big hoo-ha about Seth Rollins being the workhorse of WWE in 2019, but these days, Corey Graves, Randy Orton is certainly not a work snake. And why should he be? He's been around for ages.
What'd she say? Say, shut up, Renee. What'd she say? Say, shut up, Renee.
And next up, we have Renee Young, who was saying we've got to be worried about Triple H's tit, the same tit he tore at Super Showdown last year. It was Crown Jewel, pal. The Crown Jewel show where you broke new ground by appearing on the thing. Why wouldn't you, of all people, remember that? It's a monumental night. Big it up. P
piss in their faces.
So next up we have Greg Hamilton, who announces Braun Strowman at £385. But that thing there claims that Braun Strowman is £340, and I think I know why. Now, as we all know, Braun Strowman uses an app where he maps out around the world where he has taken a poo. So it's obvious what's happened here. Greg Hamilton was given a weight when Braun Strowman had poo inside of his big monster belly. But that there was produced after Braun Strowman took a poo. Braun Strowman's poos weigh £45. I'm 26 years old, everybody.
What'd she say? Say, shut up, Renee.
Jesus Christ, man, Renee. How on earth could you sit there on commentary on a WWE show and claim that Kofi Kingston and Dolph Ziggler, in a kayfabe sense, are equally matched? On one hand, we have Kofi Kingston, meteoric rise so far in 2019. Since WrestleMania 35, he's beaten everybody put in his way. And on the other hand, we have Dolph Ziggler, who bitches and moans and auditions for NSYNC, despite the fact NSYNC aren't even here anymore. It should have been May. But in a kayfabe sense, in WWE, in his last 12 matches, he's won one. Kofi, Dolph. Simple as that. I mean, we know what Renee was saying. Ziggler is a good wrestler, but Renee, while on commentary, should be commentating in kayfabe. So Ziggler, from a kayfabe standpoint, spunked his load at Survivor Series 2014 and hasn't recovered since.
Made a grave mistake, Corey.
And next up we have Corey Graves, who said, I definitely think Dolph Ziggler got the worst of that one. No. Now me, stood here, not athletic at all, I'll do the fall that Dolph did right now. Ooh. But I can't do the one Kofi did, because if you missed it, Kofi was stood on the top rope. He jumped off backwards from the top rope to the arena floor and landed arse/small of the back first. And I'm scared of heights as well. And next up we have the moment where Dolph Ziggler called Kofi Kingston the best WWE champion in history. I mean, he's arguably the most important WWE champion in history. He's certainly part of the most important faction in WWE history, the New Day. But to call him the best WWE champion 2 months into a reign, nah. And sticking with Ziggler, he then talks about doing a dirty deed behind somebody's back. Somebody called Dave Meltzer because Dolph Ziggler shoots on Jon Moxley. Woo! And back with Dolph Ziggler once again we go, and brace yourselves everybody, because Dolph Ziggler demanded another WWE Championship match against Kofi Kingston, and not only that, but inside of a steel cage. Aye, Dolph, and I want a 32-inch waist, pal, but I'm not getting that anytime soon, just like you're not getting a steel cage match against Kofi Kingston. Just imagine if WWE put Dolph Ziggler in yet another WWE Champion. Oh, for God's sake, man. There was 51 men in the 50-man Battle Royal. Don't believe me? Read the following list. Now, this shouldn't really be a WTF moment, because how many times can EC3 get knocked through the floor by the creative team in WWE? What the hell's he done wrong? But 20 seconds into the match, we see EC3 teetering on the top rope with Matt Hardy. The camera cuts. And EC3 is gone. The camera missed it because they were focusing on the Singh brothers. It's unbelievable. Why wouldn't you, Titus, you know, wait until the noises above your head have stopped? That means the ring's empty. Then come out, go back in, win the match. Why come out when the ring's still full? Oh, that's right, because you're Titus O'Neil. And next up, we have the moment where Corey Graves quite literally lost his voice, and he said the following afterwards, I have called 41 hours of wrestling this week. I mean, it sounds like he's exaggerating, but he's not. But Corey did also say he's got iron vocal cords, so it's a wonder he can talk at all.
Yep, I wrong, wrong, wrong. Yep, I wrong, wrong.
Hey, son, how does it feel to win the most prestigious battle royal in WWE history? WrestleMania armbar, rest in peace if you weren't already dead, which I think you were.
And I can't believe it, lads and lasses. We have another direct quote from one Michael Cole, who said the following. Stomping grounds, in 2 weeks, it's time to kick ass and take names, guys. Guys! Women! Now, I'm only making this a WTF moment because I'm sure I read on the dirty sheets at one of the Saudi shows last year, WWE showed a promo package or an advert with women in and they got told off. So to do it again is either ballsy or progressive, because the Saudis didn't kick off this time. Judging by what happened with Alexa Bliss and Natalya, I reckon it's the former. To that pissing main event we go, and I think that Goldberg was concussed before he even walked through the curtain. Now, apparently WWE told Bill,
Do not headbutt doors. That is a bad thing to do. It's a stupid thing to do, Bill, but you did it anyway. Look at that picture there. It's clear that you did. You went against the orders. What's the crack with that? And as some of you may have seen, Bill Goldberg missed his pyro, probably because somebody at Gorilla was checking his head for a concussion because he headbutted a door. Bill, why'd you headbutt them doors? Mangle Cole, know your belts. You claim that Goldberg is the only man to hold the WCW World Heavyweight Championship, the Universal Championship, and the WWE Championship, and that's not right. Goldberg, as we all know, in WWE held Raw's World Heavyweight Championship. The WWE title was on SmackDown Live, which wasn't live back then. It was just SmackDown. Silver aprons and everything. Coffins everywhere! Symbolism at its finest at Super Showdown 2019. So then, The Undertaker did not travel to Saudi Arabia on an aeroplane like a normal human being. He teleported there through a vortex or something. Look at him go. So then, to the opening stages of that main event we go, and everything was going swimmingly well, way better than we could have expected. But then we got to that knee bar, and I'll let Matt Riddle tell you what's for, because he knows about that knee bar, and I don't, quite frankly.
Look, what a knee bar, bro. What a knee bar.
That's just stupid.
Make me mad. You're making me mad. Keep it up. Keep it up, bro.
Although, despite Matt Riddle's sentiments, it must have done something, because coming out with that knee bar, Taker was hobbling. So work that one out. And then came the spear into the ring post, and if Goldberg wasn't already concussed from the headbutt to the door, which he probably was, he was certainly concussed from the spear to the ring post, because that chrome dome, it caught it flush. Now, if you hadn't guessed, I'm not a wrestler. Honestly, it's quite awful for me to stand here and tell Bill Goldberg how to do things in a professional wrestling ring when I'm stood here looking like a fat melted candle. But here I am, it's me job. Bill, don't headbutt the post, hug it with your shoulders. I'm sure that's how it's done. That's the second time now, Bill, that match against Chronic. We all know it happened then as well. Don't let it happen again. And then we have that pissing tombstone, for Christ's sake. And if Goldberg wasn't concussed from the door, and he wasn't concussed from the door and the post, he was certainly concussed from his head spiking into the mat. Now, once again, if it wasn't obvious already, I'm not a professional wrestler. I do not know the proper mechanics of how to execute a tombstone pile driver. But it's clear that something went horribly wrong for Bill Goldberg's head to spike into the mat. Like it did. It never normally happens, but it did last night, and I was getting shades of Owen versus Austin, and that's not a good thing. And then we had the rest of the botches in that match, and to be honest with you, I don't want to stand here and take the piss, because by this point of the match, it was just sad to watch. We had two of the biggest names of the past 30 years having a match way past their prime, so far past their prime, they weren't just a danger to each other, but they were a danger to themselves. Now, I'm sure we've all seen that clip where The Undertaker himself is speaking, saying he doesn't want to be that professional wrestler in the ring, having a wrestling match. A father and a son are sat at ringside, and the father turns to the son and says, I used to watch that man when he was good. But we're already so far past this point, Taker, and it pains me to say this, just give it up, please. It's horrible to watch you in the ring. You were great at one time, but now you're so far away from that. It's heartbreaking to watch you. Now, I can't stand here and begrudge Undertaker and Goldberg for getting a big payday at this stage of their respective careers, but you've got to wonder how much a big payday is worth when in comparison to their health. Both Undertaker and Goldberg could have been paralysed last night, and I'm not being dramatic here. Go and watch that tombstone and that jackhammer. You have to now wonder if Vince McMahon himself will stop these legend versus legend matches happening, because I don't know about you, I am pissing sick of hearing about retired legends not being able to do human things, normal human things, because they're so messed up. And that match last night, we were one move away from one of them being paralysed. I can't say it enough. Surely Vince McMahon himself has a responsibility on a human level not to put these matches on so one of these people don't seriously get hurt. Now, I'm getting all serious here and pissed off, quite frankly, because these two men are legitimate heroes of mine. I was born in 1992. The Undertaker has been wrestling for the entirety of my life. The first VHS I got as a kid was the WWE Superstar Series tape with Bill Goldberg on. I had no idea who he was before I watched it, but I watched it, and 7-year-old me was blown away as he flattened everybody in sight. So to know what both of these men are capable of, and then to compare it to last night's match, it's just bloody heartbreaking, gut-wrenching, awful. Vince McMahon, please create new stars with bona fide star power, because quite frankly, these old names like Goldberg and Undertaker, they need it. Not to mention the professional wrestling business as a whole. You cannot be relying on the likes of Undertaker and Goldberg to draw you a house anymore, because last night proved that they're simply not up to the task anymore of putting on a professional wrestling match to main event a card in a big arena like that. So to summarize, Vince McMahon, just sort it out, will you please? I'm sorry this video ended on such a sour note, so sour in fact, I forgot a wearing wedding ring. Sorry, Sam, I do apologise. But watching that main event last night, I was just pissed off. And I'll admit, I was one of the ones joking before last night's main event took place, wondering what a match between Undertaker, a broken Undertaker, and Goldberg, a knackered old Goldberg, was going to look like. But as the match went on, it just got sadder and sadder and sadder. And it was just, oh God, lost for words. That's it, everybody. See you next week. Thanks for watching. Let us know what you think in the comments below. You can follow us on Twitter at Cultaholic. You can find us on Facebook at facebook.com/Cultaholic. And if you enjoy what we do here at Cultaholic, you can play us to our Patreon page, patreon.com/Cultaholic. Hit subscribe and join us.